Hello and welcome everybody. So in the previous section, we started analyzing the error of kernel density estimates, and there we looked at the bias of the kernel density estimate, and we found that these estimates are biased, but that the bias is proportional to h squared. So if we take the bandwidth smaller, the bias will get smaller. Now we continue with this theme, and our aim in this video, or in this group of videos rather, is to compute the mean squared error that combines the bias we have already looked at with the variance of the estimate, which means how much does it fluctuate between instances, and then give some combined measure which we really want to minimize. And I just said this, the mean squared error combines bias and variance, so we start by determining the variance of the kernel density estimator. So that's what we'll do here. Let us see what we already know before we start. F hat of x, the estimator itself, is defined to be 1 over n, sum I from 1 to n, k h x minus x I, and k h is a rescaled kernel, so k h of x is 1 over h k of x over h, and k is a kernel function. Good. And now we are going to consider the variance of that quantity. Let me just recall what we did in the last video. In the last video, we did the usual thing. We plugged in random samples from the model in here. So we used xi distributed with density f iid. And then we use this to show that expectation of f hat h of x is, well, we did it in two steps. We first showed that that's equal to expectation of the rescaled kernel of x minus x1. And I spoke about this at the time. Instead of x1, we could also have written x2 or x3. Didn't matter, we just plug in one of them. And then we showed that that is approximately equal to f of x plus 1 half h squared mu 2 of k f double prime of x for small h. And that is only true for small h because somewhere in here we use Taylor approximation to expand f around the point x. So I wrote approximately equal here instead of an error term, and Taylor approximation only works as the point approaches x, and that translates here into small h. Good, so that's what we have done. Now we want to do exactly the same thing for the variance. So variance f hat h of x. And the first observation is the variance, well, we can write that as f hat h of x squared minus expectation of f hat h of x, and then the result squared. And this term is what I've just described. That's what we did last week. So that we already know. And we'll focus therefore on this term. So we get expectation of f hat h of x, which is square. So we work that out, and then afterwards we plug in the result from last week for the expectation of f hat, and then we'll get the variance. Good. So that is expectation of f hat multiplied with itself, that's the square, so 1 over n, sum I from 1 to n k h x minus capital X I have to write here. And now I need to write this term again, and this time I choose j for the summation index for a reason you will see in a minute. Then I can mix up the sums without any disaster, so k h x minus capital X j, and that's my f hat h squared. First thing, I can take the 1 over n out. There are two of them, so I get 1 over n squared. And then I combine the sums into 1. So I and j both go from 1 to n. Here I'm using that I chose different names for the first and second copy of the index. And then we have kh x minus xi times kh x minus xj. And now I also take the combined sum out, so that is 1 over n squared, sum ij from 1 to n, expectation of kh x minus capital xi times kh x minus capital xj. Good, so that's the first step. Now, there are two cases, it turns out. Let's first consider the case that I is different from j. So if I is different from j, then xi and xj are independent. That is written here, the xi are independent and identically distributed. And then also kh x minus xi and kh x minus xj are independent. And there is a rule if, say, x and y are independent, then the expectation of x times y equals expectation of x times expectation of y. That's a rule from probability. If the variables are independent, that is really important here, then the expectation of the product is the product of the expectations. Good, so we use this. Then expectation of kh x minus xi times kh x minus xj equals, I just said it, the product, so expectation of kh x minus xy times expectation kh x minus xj. And the xi are identically distributed. This one here and that one here is actually the same number because xi and xj have exactly the same stochastic behavior. So after I take the expectation, I get the same number. Like in the previous section, I just write x1 here for both of them. And so I get kh x minus x1 squared. Good, so that is the first case. Then the other case is obviously I equal j. In this case, expectation of kh x minus xi kh x minus xj equals, well, there is no chance they can be independent, they are the same term, so that is instead expectation of kh x minus xi squared. And like I did before, the I does not matter. They are identically distributed. I get the same value in any case, so I can write x1 here to make it clear. It's the same whatever I is. Okay, so I have this. Now, this is something, and we just need to work that out. And that works very, very similar to what we did earlier when we derived the bias. So what we do is we write that as an integral. So the rule, as always, is expectation of f of a random variable is integral f of x phi of x dx, where that here must be the density of x. And adapted to the situation here, the function is kh x minus something squared. And now I can't use x as the integration variable because x is already used here. So let's use y instead, dy. And I still need to write the density of x1. And x1 has density f, so I write f of y dy. Good. Now the steps are similar to what we have seen before. So that's integral 1 over h kh x minus y over h f of y dy. So I have this. And I've just seen I have forgotten the square. So let's add this in. Great. So the next step will be to use substitution. So what we'll do is we will set z equal y minus h, y minus x over h. That's what's in here. And then for the integral, we get dz is 1 over h dy. And what we get then is still integral 1 over h squared, kh of z squared, f of y. So we need to solve this for y. So hz is y minus x, or in other words, y equals hz plus x. So x plus hz we can write here. Dy is h dz. So we can tidy it a tiny bit. One of the h's is cancelled. 1 over h integral kh of z squared f of x plus hz dz. Now, like we did when we computed the bias, we are going to use Taylor approximation. So f of x plus hz is approximately equal to f of x plus hz f prime of x plus 1 half hz squared f double prime of x. So let's try that. We could include more terms, but it turns out these are enough. And as before, I'm not bothering here to write this error term. I just write approximately equal, and we know if needed, we could know that is a certain order in h or something like that. Good. So what we get is integral k of z squared f of x plus hz dz is integral k of z squared. And now first term is f of x. The next term is integral k of z squared hz f prime of x dz. And the next term is integral k of z squared 1 half h squared z squared f double prime of x dz. And now we can pull all the constants out of the integrals. So we get, well, first term there is just f of x times integral k of z squared dz. The next term, h and f prime of x are constants, dz is not. So we get h f prime of x integral z k of z squared dz. And last term, similarly, 1 half comes out, h squared comes out, f double prime of x comes out, and integral z squared k of z squared dz stays in. So what do we get? The first term, we cannot do anything, so instead we just define a shorthand notation for that, because that term is going to stay till the end. So that integral k squared is called the roughness of the kernel, and it is denoted r of k. Roughness is the term for it. The next term, with an argument we have seen before, vanishes, namely z is an odd function, antisymmetric, and k of z squared is an even function, that's symmetric, so the product is antisymmetric, so the integral from 0 to infinity exactly cancels the integral from minus infinity to 0, so this goes away, we don't need the second term. And the third term, again, is going to stay, but it is lower order than the first term because it has an h squared here. So if we consider small h, that will be the dominating term, and that we can neglect. Good, so that is what we get here. Now we need to plug that in what we have done before. So we have to undo quite a few steps. So let's step back a bit and do this one. Expectation of f hat of x squared. So expectation of f hat of x squared. We said is 1 over n squared and then this sum. And this sum we said has two cases, namely if I equals j, we get what we've done last. And when I is different from j, we have this expression. So let's work out how often do we have which case. So I equals j is easy. There are n cases. From 1 to n. So we have n times, and I just write a placeholder here, I will fill that in a second. Then we have all the cases where I is different from j, and well, we had n squared before, we have just dealt with n, so that's n squared minus n cases where I is different from j, and n squared minus n is n times n minus 1, and here we need to put in whatever the result is for I different from j. So that will be our result. Then I equals j, that was what we started here, and that went on to 1 over a integral of k squared. I made a mistake here, let me fix this in red. So after I take the h squared out, I do not need the h here anymore, there is no h here and here. Here it is right again. So we have 1 over h, that integral, and that integral we worked out here. And I said this is the leading term, so we have 1 over h times this. 1 over h roughness of k times f of x. And then the other term, I not equal to j, that is what we did here. And there we got this expectation, which I for now just want to copy because it will turn out we already know that one. So let me just write that. Expectation of kh x minus x1 squared. Good, and we first cancel things a bit. So 1 over n squared times n is 1 over n. So we have 1 over n times h roughness of k f of x. And then we have n times n minus 1 divided by n squared. So that's n minus 1 over n expectation of kh x minus x1 squared. So that's one thing. And also, I was a bit sloppy with notation here. I should probably write approximately equal to, because I neglected all but the leading term here in Taylor approximation. So that thing we only expect to be true for small h. Good. So that's what we have. And now I said we don't need to do this term because we already know what it is. That refers to this one, namely in the previous lecture where we worked out the bias, we had that as an intermediate step, so that here equals the expectation of f hat. So that is this. Then this squared is the expectation of f hat squared, and that actually does something good, namely the variance is what we want, and we have just done this term, but we are going to subtract another expectation of f hat squared, so we can merge this with the term we have left over. So what we get is the variance of f hat h of x is this one, 1 over n h times the roughness of k times f of x, and then plus from the previous slide n minus 1 over n, I leave a gap here, expectation of f hat h of x squared. And then for the variance, we also need to do minus expectation of f hat h of x squared. So we can use n minus 1 over n minus 1 as a prefactor, and in both terms have this expectation squared in. And now we subtract these two fractions, that's 1 over n expectation f hat h of x squared. So that's what we get. Let's just draw a line here just to keep that as an intermediate result, because we are doing so many steps in a row. So there is one last step I want to do here, namely, I said we know that from the previous section, and I have never actually plugged in the result. So in the previous section, we said expectation of f hat h of x squared is approximately equal f of x plus 1 half h squared second moment of k f double prime of x squared. We didn't actually have the square in the previous section. We just said expectation of f hat of h is approximately equal to that. So that would be f of x squared plus 1 half, well, something doesn't really matter, with h squared plus something with h to the 4. And I will show you here, we don't need these terms, we just can stick with the leading term. So if we do that, then what we get is variance of f hat h of x is 1 over n h roughness f of x minus 1 over n f of x. I should write approximately equal here because there is a second approximation, minus 1 over n, and then something I said we could ignore, times h squared and so on. And if we look at that, we are interested in small h. Actually, the dominating term is this one here, because that has a 1 over h in, though that term increases when h goes to 0. That term stays constant, and that term decreases, and this one here, which I've now not written, decreases even faster. So the leading term is actually that one. So even this was already negligible compared to that for small h. So what we have here is the variance is approximately equal to that for small h as the leading term, and the next term is constant and would be f of x minus 1 over n x f of x. So that is true as h goes to 0. Good, and that now finally is the variance of f hat h of x for small h. Great, so with this in place, we can now come to the mean squared error, but I leave this to the next video. So see you soon.